Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'm glad to finally be back. Crazy preaching schedule and the different events that kept coming up kept me out of here for a little bit. I'm glad to be back. Last time we discussed, I had to like double check everything because it's been a bit since I was working on this sermon series. We talked about how we find victory in Jesus despite the suffering we deal with. And today we're going to talk about another difficult concept, is how can a loving God have any concept of something called wrath? And so why am I talking about this concept? Because growing up, going through scripture, growing up, this context and this idea was something that always, especially coming from the United Methodist theology background of grace and mercy, how can God ever be angry? What does anger even mean in the context of a perfect God? Because we always have this negative connotation surrounding it, we always have this imperfect understanding of what anger is, because when we think of anger, we think of tough situations or nasty situations. But we see in the Bible, everywhere where God does have this sort of anger, it's normally in the context of either perfect justice or because an agreement or covenant's been broken. Now, there's some interesting things. The term wrath is just anger. It's kind of an archaic word, but normally when we say wrath, we mean this sort of righteous or divine anger. But for some reason, we still get this really bad negative context. The discussions in modern times normally around this aspect of God normally really make it difficult. But we do see in the Old Testament, we see all these places where despite some of the tough stories in the Old Testament, we still see God's love and glory come forth in the difficult situations that Israel deals with and everywhere else. I think about sometimes the times that I've felt angry from things I heard on TV or the internet, news, but this inner fury I have in my own mind is nothing compared to what God's anger is. And it's not to say that it's scary, it's just that it is not malicious, it is not, God's all-knowing. These responses that he has are only because of injustice caused by the choices of humanity. But think of how we talk about God like a heavenly father. You've had to scold kids. So we see him as like this parent in our lives. And you don't think he doesn't get frustrated with us and our things that we do? This life cycle between Israel turning away from God and turning back to God over and over is reminiscent of that. To really establish what I'm trying to get at here, we'll look at one of the minor prophets, Nahum, from chapter 1, verses 2 through 6. A jealous and avenging God is the Lord. The Lord is avenging and wrathful. The Lord takes vengeance on his adversaries and rages against his enemies. The Lord is slow to anger, but great in power, and the Lord will by no means clear the guilty. His way is in the whirlwind and storm, and the clouds are the dust of his feet. He rebukes the sea and makes it dry, and dries up all the rivers. Bashan and Carmel wither, and the bloom of Lebanon fades. The mountains quake before him, and the hills melt. The earth heaves before him, the world and all who live in it. Who can stand before his indignation? Who can endure the heat of his anger? His wrath is poured out like fire, and by him the rocks are broken in pieces. Now, this is normally not something I like to pick from the Bible. It doesn't sound very pleasant. However, it is something that we have to reconcile with. Because, well, what's the context of this passage? Well, Nahum, if you've ever read it before, is one of the minor prophet books. And it's a collection of poems describing the downfall of the Assyrian empire because of its transgressions it put forth on Israel. In Nahum's time, there was no sort of clearing of the guilty, because sacrifices, even in those days of sacrificial system, only was a sort of incomplete acknowledgement of one's sin and never fully paid the full atonement. And so he prophesied about this downfall. But this first proclamation here is this really scary image. Because God cannot stand injustice. He can't live in the same room as it. Yet we see when he's incarnated as the Son, we see him living in the midst of injustice. The Romans oppressing Israel, for example. We see Jesus going and showing a different way from the old system. And we see these two things side by side, these images, and it makes us want to pick either one side of the Bible or the other. Or we hyper-focus on one character or aspect of God and ignore the other. It's something I've had to wrestle with for a long time. But the context for this story is that Israel is suffering and being oppressed because of their own failure to follow God through these old covenants. We needed this history to know, to learn, you know, the adage goes, you have to learn from history, you're doomed to repeat it. If we didn't know what was the wrong thing to do, we wouldn't know what the right thing to do is, because sometimes we don't listen to just the rules. Adam and Eve had nothing prior to go on, and they didn't listen to God. But yet, despite this, Jesus Christ still was incarnated. So if God gets angry, why would Jesus Christ show up? Well, note that it says slow to anger. God doesn't just use his anger on every little grievance that people throw forth on him. There's many places in the Bible where there's mercy, and there's not that so-called eye for an eye or tooth for a tooth. In Paul in Romans 12, chapter 12, verses 17 through 21, he says, do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And Paul's just, and this passage is just following up from Jesus Christ's example of turning the other cheek and things of that nature. In 1 John we read the following, beloved, let us love one another because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loves us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. And he just keeps going and going, establishing this idea. So we see Jesus Christ as his perfect manifestation of love. we also see these stories, and it can make a really uncomfortable image. For myself, when I was younger, it was an uncomfortable image trying to deal with those two things. I recall talking about last year about Passover, how, for example, the Egyptians killed all of the kids, for example, but God only didn't do eye for eye. He took the firstborns away. Now, am I still comfortable with that story? No. I'd rather there be no death, right? That's the ideal. But Pharaoh's heart was hardened. If you look to Jesus Christ, there's only a handful of times he's angry. One time I always remember is when he goes into the temple where his father resides. And he kicks out all the money changers. What kind of anger is that? Is that an anger that says I'm going to destroy everything? Or is it just an anger pointing out the injustice or the wrong? The point I'm trying to make is Jesus Christ models for us how we're supposed to behave in some sense. That doesn't mean we're not going to have our own personalities and our own weaknesses. But for myself, who struggles with anger, that means I have to set my own anger aside and be humble before God. Because I realize now that God is the only one that has a true righteous anger. The only thing I'm called to is to proclaim the good news. And that is a difficult thing, because we do want to provide that sort of discipline and that help in churches to help people through their things. But there's a difference between how Christ does this and how the world does it. The world will shame you and just point out your sins. And the way it so-called convicts is not the way Christ convicts us. Christ calls us to turn around, repent, and believe in this good news. He doesn't have every sin on this list that he reads off when we die or something. No, you're clean. As soon as you accept Christ, that grace envelops your life, and all of it is white, clean. But some people will say, but really? Am I really good? Don't I need to do a little extra, whether it be works or things? Because we look to old stories in the Old Testament where people had to work to try to please God and things of that nature. But we remember that Paul says the old law was like a school teacher. It was just there to kind of help guide us long enough before Christ could come. And so we see so many different things for where Christ is telling us to act in a better way than maybe we are predisposed to. I can't tell you how many times I would read something or a story and my face would get red-faced. frustrated with something that's going on. But we see in Scripture, Christ tells people of another way. James and John in the Bible are called the sons of thunder because of the passion that they have for Christ's message, but also because of how quick they were to react to those that they did not like. When they went into an old Samaritan village, the Samaritans did not receive Jesus well because they thought he was going to Jerusalem to topple the government, and they didn't want anything to do with that. They didn't want anything to do with another war with Rome. And so James and John get angry at these people and ask Jesus, do you want us to cast hellfire on them? And Jesus yells at them instead. He says, you don't know what you're asking. He's like, you don't know. He's like, we're not here for that. And so that's another time we see him angry. We see another time where he says, "Get behind me, Satan," to Peter, because Peter can't recognize the full glory of Jesus Christ yet. They only see him as the Messiah, but not as that true Savior, the one that saves souls, the one that saves hearts. And so, God only ever uses anger in a very limited context. That context is super limited. And so, if the all-perfect and all-just God, the one that executes righteous judgment, has a limit to what he does, and is actually much more merciful than people realize, what does that say about us when we're angry? What does it say about me? How can I let my ego be so bold to think that I know better than God? God, why aren't you casting down, you know, something in this situation? Yet he doesn't, because he's merciful. He shows mercy to thousands of generations and only repays it with one. That is the tension, because we can't grasp the entire nature of God. We have the Trinity that helps us deal with the relationships. We have all the different creeds that help us describe what we believe and what we know. But there's so much more other than that we don't know. We can't pretend to be like God. God calls us to obey his law. He tells us of two commandments, to love thy neighbor and love him. How can I love if I'm just full of anger? It gets really difficult. How do we let go of the anger of the things that are pulling us back from around us? Jesus shows that there are more positive ways to take that anger and turn it into something more righteous. He shows the positive ways of protest, for example. He shows how one can turn the cheek, and while it seems like a submissive thing, it's actually standing up to the person and refusing to stoop down to their level. Because a backhand slap, it means that you're being slapped as a lesser. But if you turn the other cheek, they're forced, because they always slapped at that time with the right hand. I swear this is true. I've read it and studied it. That meant they had to slap you as an equal. What a strange positive protest Christ calls us to, or to walk the extra mile. Romans, for example, were only allowed to walk, make people walk 1 mile. But if people would insist on a second mile, that's a positive protest. That's one way to take your anger out. Show them a different way. It'll show the injustice of the situation, because it'll look ridiculous. Well, wait a minute, they already went 1 mile. Why are they going 2 miles? And then they start to reflect, well, why do we even make people walk 1 mile? It starts a conversation without you having to say a word, simply by behavior. That's why Christ's commands talk more about actions than it is about just saying the right words. It's not that the words don't matter. No, these are the words of life and truth. But it's that if the life and truth lives in us, we should be seeing that fruit flow forth. Basically, what I'm trying to wrestle with is, how do we surrender our anger to God in a way that's actually true surrender? I can't answer that for everyone today. Sometimes I can't even answer it for myself. Sometimes I look to Lamentations in the Bible, like in the Psalms, the ones that really call for really tough things. But I find them very soothing, because they remind me of the stories of God's justice, that he does not leave his people. He does not leave those in the muck. He is constantly knocking at the door. He is constantly fighting for us. If there's no death is on our side, in a sense, is how it's described in the Bible. And so if even death is on our side, who can stand against us? If I cannot die because I would be resurrected, what Do I really, are the stakes really that high that I have to be that mentally involved in certain worldly things that are making me angry instead of focusing on God's commission? What is it that I'm letting turn into an altar of anger, an idol, where I'm sacrificing my anger to a false idol about issues instead of taking that anger and surrendering it to God? That doesn't mean not get involved with things, but we have to have a clear head on our shoulders. If we're just full of indignation and anger, we can't get anywhere. We can't be peacekeepers. John describes love. I can't read it all off the top of my head, but he describes all the things it is and it is not. And so the question becomes, like, is your anger based in love or is it based in something else? And that's a difficult question to ask. But the thing is that regardless of whatever we struggle with, regardless of whether we ever, say, get past that issue in current society where everyone just is at each other's throats, the thing is that Christ paid for it all. He died for all. He died for those who would accept him and accept his eternal life that he offers. This isn't just some cheap payment. He calls us to carry a cross. Each person carries some burden, and it's hard to even be told that. It's like that feeling of, God, you're supposed to save me. Why are you adding more onto my shoulders? But it's because he wants each of us to be a blessing to the world. As it says with Abraham, that Abraham will be a blessing to the nations. So does God call all Christians to be a blessing to all the nations around them. We're called to be a blessing to the people in our communities and to everyone around us. And that is why Christ summed up all of the law into two commands: love thy God and love thy neighbor. Are we still continuing to follow those commandments today? On that, let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this tough message this morning. I wrestled with it a little bit trying to think how to say it and what to talk about. I thank you for everyone here that is patient with me through my ministry. I thank you for this past year or so, how much we've been learning through you all the different deep scriptural truths. I ask that you help us to remember these scriptural truths and not set them aside, that they might move us to work for your kingdom and your glory, not for our own. Lord, help me to set aside my own frustration and anger when I see situations that I don't think are right. Help me to see the whole truth. Help me to humble myself, to realize that there are times that people were probably looking at me on something and angry with me, saying he has broken this law or that law in the Bible. Lord, help me to be humble to remember I too am a sinner. That you are the only one that has righteous anger. You're the only one that's capable of executing correct justice. And so by you, we ask that you give that spirit to each and every one of us again, that you continue to, so that we might find that peace with those around us and that peace within our communities. I thank you for all of this, Lord. Amen. We have a final hymn, 657. Thank you. And so we should rejoice that God, in his infinite love, sacrificed his Son as the ultimate atonement for all sin, that we might find ourselves simply resting in his grace so that we can focus on the mission that he has called us to do. Reflect on this gift of God's love that we have each and every day. May you all have a blessed Sunday and rest of your week. Amen.